I want to talk about feedstocks, what to feed them and what not to feed them. It's really important because some of you can have certain waste streams, others aren't going to have access to anything. So what are they going to eat? Food scrap waste. The more energetic, the better. Fresh food scraps. Coffee grounds. Brewery waste. Manures are way down on the list in regards to bioconversion. Food scraps in the average pods is about 20% bioconversion. What does that mean, 20%? That means you have 100 pounds of food scraps, you're going to get 20 pounds of mature grub bodies, 20%. So 100 pounds get about 20 pounds of grubs. Manures, especially the herbivore manures, they're going to be much lower, you know, 6 to 10%, really low on the bioconversion. Omnivores and carnivores, a little bit higher, because there's more energy in their poop. So I bioconvert all my cat poop. I have a pod, it's sort of my second cat litter bin. So I use a corn stover-based litter that seems to break down in the pods. I don't know if the microbes are doing it or if the black soldier fly, some of the digestive enzymes are helping to do it. But that produces a really nice soil amendment, and it's just all cat poop and corn stover. You gotta moisten it because it's very dry. So manures, I personally think there are better uses of manures than putting in your pod. Age it, put it in your garden. Age your chicken poop for 6 months in bags out in the sun. Put it in your asparagus. Good, don't waste time doing it in the pod. It's just messy. One thing I think is okay is rabbit poop, because it definitely has the moisture balance of a good feedstock for black soldier fly. Again, they're herbivores, so it's going to be a smaller. But it adds a little bit of bulk and fluff, and I notice it seems to drain well, and there's a lot of beneficial applications to rabbit pellets, other than my fig trees, which seem to do really well on rabbit pellets. Anyway, and it doesn't burn, it doesn't have a lot of energy. You know, you put chicken poop in there, and it just increases the temperature precipitously, and it can go over the danger zone, and you don't want to do that. Rabbit poop, not so much. So, the 110 is the crisis temperature. If you start seeing your light-colored grubs showing up in your harvest bucket, mixed in with your black-colored ones, which are the mature ones, which are the ones that should be crawling off, it's too hot. Usually I see that happen during twice a year doing the heat waves in the Piedmont area, which is where I live. Maybe 110 is around the temperature I've noticed the critical, where I start seeing the cream colors in my collection bucket. Have you ever seen those blue briquettes that are pretty hard that you put in coolers? I throw some of those in my pod to cool it down because I don't want to deal with the little ones crawling off. And I just dump the bucket back in. Yes, Tim?
What about grass scraps?
No, they're not going to eat. Don't feed them biomass that's like woody that you would put in your compost pile. No twigs, branches, leaves, grass, paper. No, they're not going to eat lignin-based stuff. Hemicellulose, no.
Not even grass?
I don't see them eating grass. Now, there are some plants they're going to eat, like the plants that we eat, the lettuces and stuff like that. Juice waste is a great, really good moisture balance, Tim. That juice waste will get eaten, and it has a great surface to volume ratio, so you know it's a lot less time to digest. Have all of you heard duckweed? Duckweed? Okay. If you're not growing duckweed, you need to start growing it this year, and there's no excuses. I don't want to excuse Mrs. Brown, okay, that you have for not growing duckweed, because not only will your chickens eat your duckweed, you can take handfuls of the duckweed and throw it in the pod, and it'll disappear in one day. It's crazy scary. Yes?
What about roadkill?
Yes. Any offal, any guts, any animal cuttings, clippings, cooked animal waste bioconverts and gets eaten faster than raw. Will raw get eaten? Absolutely. Don't go putting in 30, 40 pounds of raw innards and not expecting some odor, okay? Unless you have a really active pod. Monitor the food waste that you throw in there. You don't want to put more that they can't eat in 1 to 2 days. If you have infected birds, you throw all those infected birds in. Even though the black soldier fly are okay, they might have something on the surface, so you may want to clean the harvest in a way that maybe eliminates any potential. And so you just want to use your common sense. It has to do more with contamination than it does the actual black soldier fly. I think it's just always good to be precautionary with stuff.
Yeah. North Carolina did find that pathogens were making it through on the outsides of the pupa, so there was a contamination risk. And I think people should be real careful. But I mean, talking about roadkill and stuff like that, if you're thinking about feeding, animals that you're going to then eat from, I would, either be sure that you were trying not to be introducing pathogens to as feedstock, or think about some way to pasteurize the pupa before you feed them to your chickens.
Yeah, and there's different ways to pasteurize pupa for sure.
Ultraviolet probably.
Oh yeah, just basically out in the sun is going to, if you guys, who here is dehydrating foods using sun? Okay, great, this is not going to be a big jump to dehydrate your grubs. That's a great way to pasteurize them, okay? Now that they may be sacrificed because of that and they're no longer alive, but is all the energy there for your chickens and fish still? Yeah, it's probably no longer alive because they're dehydrated.
Yeah. But I would actually, if you're in the biz and you're selling food to people, I would actually test. If you're doing something like outdoor natural ultraviolet and stuff, I would test. And there's a company in Tennessee that's pretty cost effective that I used when I was making compost and had to test regularly. Industrial Microbial in Tennessee. They used to be $25 for a test, but I would test for a few different pathogens. Make sure that your process is actually coming up pathogen free before.
Always err on the side of caution and assume there's something bad. I think if you just assume there's something bad, then you'll be good. Don't be careless. I don't go sticking my hands in pods with open wounds if I have cuts or something like that, just because you never know. And it's just safe, and so far so good. We haven't seen a lot of problems that are in the literature, a black soldier fly, pathogen contaminations, but anything's possible if your feedstock is contaminated. It's not the species that's doing it, it's the feedstock. So it's only as good as the feedstock. We were talking about the clean coffee grounds. Coffee grounds are sterilized because they're heated up and steamed, and they tend to be very sterile. Same with brewery waste. So the feedstock is really the secret to your success. But will they eat all that? Will they eat roadkill? Yeah. What they won't eat. Edward, give me a list of something. Just name one thing that you don't think they're going to eat.
Probably not going to eat grass.
Okay, they're not going to eat grass.
Pine needles.
Not going to eat pine needles. They're not going to eat wood chips.
Avocado
pits are not, no pits or seeds are going to get eaten. The rinds of avocado don't get eaten. The avocado gets eaten very quickly, but not the rinds. Citrus rinds, don't put them in your pot. There's too many terpenes in them, and the chemistry of citrus rinds is toxic to a lot of things. That's why we use them as cleaners. So don't put them in your pots. The inside of the citrus, yeah.
Onions.
They eat that. They eat all the onion stuff. I have not seen them not eat onion, but that was a good guess, Ellen. So I'll give you a B minus on that. Huh?
They eat the papery skin.
It disappears, but again, Pat, it might be the microbes. I think, because it's so thin, just like, so I don't know if it's the digestive enzymes, because it's probably, there's not a lot of calories there, is there? Let's see, what else doesn't
get? Unless they eat quercetin, Italian quercetin.
You throw a carcass in there, mammalian bones don't tend to break down. Some of the softer bones I've noticed with fish and chickens, they tend to disappear. Again, I think it's more the milieu of digestive enzymes rather than the black soldier fly, but they tend to disappear. There's nobody here in this room should have less than 20 of these. I'm not kidding. They are good for everything. They're good for mixing. Just get them. They're great for food storage if there's ever some type of crisis in this world, God forbid. They're just great resource for many things. And if you think you have too few, just double how many you think you need. But you can get food grade now at Lowe's for $3.33, I believe, with the lid.
Jumping backwards a little bit.
Yeah.
Animal fat, say, you butcher a hog and you're processing, can the animal fat go into the tub?
Yes, they will actually eat it quite well. They have the digestive enzymes too. So things with low calorie that are very woody, don't feed them. So stems, branches, that type of stuff. I noticed broccoli stems, they tend to stay in there a while, so I think they're having a tough time digesting down the broccoli stems. And you'll learn, basically the bad American diet does really well in here. So like all the stuff at restaurant weight just gets eaten in 1 to 2 days. The funny thing is, when I first started to work for this company and I was doing some trial testing, I would dump maybe a half bucket of this into the pod, and I come back the next day, I'm like, where are my food scraps? So I was thinking there's some raccoon or something's eating my food scraps, or my neighbor Les is playing a joke on me. So I decided to do some time-lapse photography, and it scared the crap out of me how quick they actually eat it. It's not just not a day, it actually is maybe more like 8 to 12 hours. But they do eat it very quickly. Yeah, Taylor.
So I was making me think about, have you seen, like, I'm imagining it's a two-stage system where you could have more of the high lignin, higher carbon material in the bottom, like a well-aerated space where you could have red wigglers on the bottom stage and an upper stage with soldier fly larvae. I wonder if that's a possible...
That hasn't been invented yet, and it makes a lot of sense because they work very well together. The problem is, all black soldier fly undigested residue, what's left after they finished, is great for your worm bin. It's one of the best things because it's sort of pre-digested, and all the stuff that's left over is what worms prefer. The problem is, a lot of people feed their worm bins food scraps, and these will outcompete red worms. So a lot of people are like, oh, my worm bin's ruined with black soldier flies. They took over. Well, it's because they're feeding your worm bin the wrong stuff. If your worm bin is being infested by black soldier fly, switch foods. Your worm bin should be getting shredded cardboard and some grit. And that's it. Don't give them anything more. There's enough cardboard on this planet. You don't need to feed them anything high value. Give the high value stuff to the black soldier fly. I have some cattle troughs that I repurposed into basically vermiculture. I have them in full shade, and I just give them cardboard that I've soaked about a week, and they do great. And I give them a little grit, I give them a little sand that I have down near the pond, and I throw that in for digestive purposes, and that's it. And it's great, and I don't get any black soldier fly. So, yes, Pat.
Carl, I would propose a slightly different regime, but this still can be very convenient for the average household, which
okay.
is to separate the stuff that the soldier flies don't do that well with, like the outer leaves, the stems, stuff like that. The stuff basically the rats wouldn't eat either. And then you can actually have your backyard, what used to be rat motel. You know, the people that may not want to know it, but if you look at the average backyard compost pile, you'll see these holes. It's about the size a rat will go in. Well, that's who's in there, you know, because they will eat all the scraps you're throwing out there. If you then take the stuff that they would eat and put it in your pot, and then put the other stuff, all those skin, if you have a garden, you have a lot of that stuff, right? All the outer leaves of the lettuce, all the outer leaves of all the plants, those broccoli stems, all that goes into that backyard pile, you know? Then you have this cold pile, it's not the best pile, you make a hot pile in the fall when you have a lot of material. But for the average household, it's a great way to not be breeding rats and have the other stuff, or it can go in the worm box.
Pat, you're exactly right. I actually have two compost carriers in my kitchen. One with the high energy foods that I know are going to feed to the grubs, the fats, the leftover Asian and Mexican foods, and then sort of like the leafy, green, stuffy, stemmy stuff that go for the worms, and it's great. And I never get black soldier fly in my worm bin because
banana
of that.
Peel,
yeah, Krista.
So what
right.
about
black soldier fly like banana peels though?
They do. Okay.
Yeah.
They like
potassium. Yeah. Are you talking the raw foods? I mean, when you have like meal scraps, condiments, sauces, whatever, are those things not supposed to go into it? Or I mean,
try it all out. High salt stuff, be careful, but try the different condiments and see how it goes. You'll know what doesn't get eaten. It'll still be there. Yeah, Taylor.
Usually, I'm just thinking from acidity's point of view, because like vinegar is a high acidic, and it seems like their diet and their environment is more high alkaline. I don't know if that would burn their skin.
But the microbes will change that. I mean,
oh, sure.
The microbes.
Right.
There's a lot of pH buffering goes on in there, and it sort of adjusts to their preferred equilibrium. I don't know if I'd worry so much about fermented foods or acetic acid or vinegar foods. Try it. Don't go pouring, you know, several gallons in, but yeah, Rocco.
Sweet potatoes, starchy, all that.
We'll eat it all. If it's cooked foods, they seem to bioconvert it better, just like we digest cooked foods better. It just has to do with the ease of digestion.
I think if you figure out what rats like, That's what the soldier flies eat.
Yeah, that's very true. But
if you don't feed rats, you can instead feed your soldier flies, and you can keep things pretty.
Okay. Does everybody think they're ready for infrastructure? Do you guys have additional questions on this actual species, the biology, the life cycle?
The end product, the poo, what is the analysis of that? Biology, is there pathogens associated? Has it been pasteurized in the process?
Okay.
And what kind of MPK, CN ratio?
Okay, remember we talked about the bioconversion rate being about 20% for food scraps. Well, if you have 100 pounds of food scraps, there's going to be about 5 pounds of undigested residue. In that undigested residue is basically everything they can't break down. The hemicellulose, the lignin, maybe other materials that just are inorganic. But also their castings are in there, and their exoskeletons, and that's all mixed together. That undigested residue is not compost. It hasn't had time to compost down. These things are faster than microbes. So it is not ready as a soil amendment. I wouldn't put it as a soil amendment. I would do two things with it. Either put it into a vermiculture system, because it is not fully broken down, and the microbial activity is not a stable one in order to use it as a soil amendment. Another thing is I would add it to the compost pile. They're the two uses I have for it. There may be additional uses. Pat, have you ever heard of additional uses of the undigested residue that's left over besides putting it in your compost bin or utilizing it as a vermiculture feedstock?
Yeah, I think those are the appropriate ones.
And again, Brian, there is so small a quantity. You'll throw buckets of food in there, and if you forget to feed them in a couple days, they're just like fish out of water. There's nothing left in there. It's kind of scary. They just eat everything down. So it takes a long time to actually build up appreciable amounts of leftovers. Now, if you're adding paper scraps or other things that you know they're not eating out for the purposes of fluffing or bulking, then you're going to get buildup quicker. So expect the stuff, if you're adding things that you know they're not digesting down, you're going to get bulk more. Yeah?
I think that you're talking about harvesting that undigested stuff at the end of the season.
End of the season, never in the beginning, unless you're in the tropics where you're doing, or you're doing it in year-round climate, like indoors in a greenhouse, then obviously because you have it going all the time, you're going to probably have to harvest that twice a year. What I do is when that hard freeze hits in November, I use Thanksgiving weekend to dump my pod because that keeps me from spending money, and I'm all about really trying to not be part of that whole, you know, consumer culture over the holiday. So I try to clean my pod out. I dump the whole thing in my compost, one of my compost bins. So that's a good time after the hard freeze and they're dormant. And what that also does is there's a lot of larvae still in there. So I'm giving them sort of a nice area where it's warm and they can finish their life cycle. And then in the spring, they hatch out. What I've done is amplified the local population because there's a repository created in my compost bin for them to overwinter, which is warmer and safer and hopefully more protected from predation than out in the wild. So, yes, Ellen?
So I'm still confused about what the end products actually are. Are they just the
grubs? And I, you know what? Let me clarify in the life cycle. This species goes through egg, baby larva, bigger larva, biggest larva, prepupa, which is the black color. That black color prepupa, which it lost its mouth part and its real goal is just to find a place to go and pupate out, there's a natural tendency of this species when it hits the prepupa charcoal color phase to separate out of its active pile of food scraps. So what it does is it wants to evacuate, and what we've designed is our technology around that evacuation. So it climbs up the ramps and drops in the hole, and you don't have to separate it out of the food scraps. They auto-harvest and separate themselves with our technology, making it so much easier than redworms, which you have to do a little bit of finesse and finagling to get them to separate out. I am busy doing other things on the farm, just as you are. I don't want to have to separate out my grubs. But the grubs are the coveted finished product of black soldier fly bioconversion. You want that for feed for your fish, feed for your chickens, feed for your baby pigs. Yes, Pat?
A question about
question, and that would have to cover something.
Yeah, we're going to talk about infrastructure next.
But my question is, worms will definitely like start to leave their environment because of huge pressure drops. You can get these like migrations of worms. That doesn't occur with these guys, I presume, right?
I haven't heard about pressure issues. I know that when there's a color change and the larva reach the final stage of its grub phase, they want to evacuate. And there's different ways they evacuate. Now, if we're living in Phoenix and it's really dry and your pod is overly dry, your grubs won't crawl off at the bioconversion rate as they would here. So dry pods, you get less crawl off. It's funny because I have a spray bottle near my pod, and during heat waves we've had where it's really dry, I just go like this and all of a sudden they start crawling out. I knew it was too dry. They're not going to crawl out. They're going to stay in it. And their whole philosophy is, okay, I'm going to die of desiccation if I leave this pile. I'm just going to stay in it. But if it's moist, like the consistency of, who said grits? Somebody said grits earlier. Grits or oatmeal, they'll crawl off. Yes, Ellen.
Moist like those coffee grounds.
Yeah. I would say even a little bit moisture is fine. There's a balance. If you make it too moist, you're going to drive out the oxygen. So if it's too stinky and it's sloppy, then it's probably too moist. If it's more moist than that, but yet you don't detect any foul smells, it's okay. I would say you want to push the moisture as far as you can get it before you create stinkiness, okay? Because I've noticed with the more moisture, you get higher rates of bioconversion and better crawl off. When it's overly dry, you get less crawl off. When you have less than optimal environments in your pods or in your do-it-yourself colony, you're going to incentivize the house flies. So odor that's foul incentivizes house flies. Good odor incentivizes black soldier fly. Too dry, too moist, you're going to incentivize house fly. Somewhere in the happy medium, and it's taken me a couple years to get it right, but...
But you want it to be smelly at the beginning to attract them.
You want it to be smelly, ripe smelly, not foul smelly. There's definitely a distinction.
Fermenty,
you know, like a ripe papaya, ripe fruit smell, that smells great. Soured corn smell, pet kibble smell, not a puke smell. Okay, yeah. They will eat putrescent waste, but pukey waste, you're attracting house flies, and it's not what you want.
So how do you deal with the cat litter?
The cat litter, it's very dry. I actually have to moisten it. So I add some moisture and I let it soak. So I have a little tray similar to this tray that I throw the corn stover based pet litter in. It's very fine. It's almost like clay, but it's not clay. It's corn stover. And I make sure that there's no additional chemicals. And by the way, chemicals are a detriment to the species. The grubs, not so much, but the adults are very sensitive to pesticides, herbicides, and other types of chemicals. So remember that. If you think the spray that you have could harm insects, don't spray it near your pods, or you're going to kill the females around there, which you want in there. So be very careful about spraying. Got it? They're very sensitive. I mean, like bee sensitive.
Two things. Does anybody not know what housefly pupa look like? That could pass around.
Is it the orange one?
It's the reddish.
The reddish? Yeah. They form what's like a chrysalis. You know a chrysalis, like a monarch butterfly forms a chrysalis? They form a hard shell chrysalis that is very, so if you see those, you know you have houseflies. And you may see some in your bucket the first 2 weeks. So yeah. You think we're ready for infrastructure
now?
Well,
I want you to cover the difference between tea and
UK. I can definitely talk about that. Holy smokes, is that rain?
Probably,
that's
yeah.
Awesome.
It does it all the time here.
Okay, the liquid effluent. Remember how we said there's about 20% grubs in the 100 pounds of food scraps, about 5% undigested residue, which will eventually become compost or something else. There's also liquid effluent. The liquid effluent is predicated on the feedstock. So food scraps, very high in liquid. So you're going to get an enormous amount of liquid drainage in food scraps from restaurants. That is not tea. So that's not compost tea. Don't call it tea. Tea is something completely different biologically and chemically. This is leachate. Effluent. I call it effluent, but leachate's a good word. It's basically when food scrap is broken down through a digestive mechanism and you releasing water, it's that. But it's microbially active, and there's a lot of potential pathogens in there. So you want it to be utilized in a way that kind of just doesn't let it sit, doesn't let it stand. And when we talk about infrastructure, I'll tell you what I do for the liquid. And you could take it that approach. You want to save a little bit because of the secret sauce that I mentioned about warding off houseflies, but also being used to attract the pregnant females. Do you think we should take a break so that we can have better sound quality a few minutes from now after the storm passes, or should I keep going? Okay.
Okay, one last thing though. Treat the effluent like you would treat raw manure.
Yes.
As far as safety goes. That's how you relate to it. It's the same thing as raw manure.
Oh, we'll talk about that. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.